Evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Obiora Okafor. You're all welcome to the 6th annual OPUTA Lectures on Governance in Africa. You're all welcome to York University and Osgoode Law School and the Nathanson Center for Transnational Crime, Human Rights and Security, the sponsors of the lecture series. It's our pleasure once again to be able to welcome a distinguished lecturer who will be introduced shortly, so I won't get into his or her identity right now. But it's a pleasure to host the lecturer today. It's also a pleasure to be able to honor Justice Chukwudefo Akunne Oputa, great judge, great Nigerian scholar, in this way, which we've been doing since 2004. As many of you know, the inaugural Oputa lecture was given by was sometime Foreign Minister of Nigeria, Chief Ojomadwekwe, who incidentally is going to be the Nigerian High Commissioner to Canada recently. So York has been bringing people from Nigeria to Canada in many different ways. Justice Oputa, as many of you know, was a judge of the Nigerian Supreme Court for many years, the years that the 80s that scholars have described as the golden years of the Supreme Court. He was also lately the chair of the Human Rights Investigation Commission, convened by the federal government. And the lecture series is, of course, in his honor. Just before I turn over the mic to Associate Dean Punampuri, who is here, I just wanted to recognize the presence of some people here who are on the delegation of the guest speaker. We have amongst us Senator Nuruddin Usman of the Senate of the Nigeria. Senator Usman, please. Please, a round of applause for Senator Usman. We also have Honorable Toby Okechukwu of the House of Representatives of Nigeria. Honorable Toby Okechukwu. We have Mr. Yusuf, Minister in the Nigerian High Commission in Ottawa, who is here representing the High Commission. He just stepped out, okay. And Mr. Peter Eze, my own former colleague and senior at the University of Nigeria. Glad to have him here. And we have special assistant to the Deputy Senate President, Mr. Uche Anichukwu, as well, over there. It's a round of applause. Nigerian-Canadian, who's presently working in Nigeria, Mr. Ndubuisi Nwigwe, also a special assistant. And Mr. Smith Ichaka, as well, the delegation. Thank you. They've traveled a long way to be here, and we're glad that you're able to make it. Thank you for coming. With that, I'll turn over the mic to Associate Dean for Research and Graduate Studies at Osgoode Law School, Punampuri. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Okafor. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the 6th Annual OPUTA Lecture on Governance in Africa. On behalf of Osgoode Hall Law School, I'd like to thank all of you for coming. And as Obi said, my role is that I'm Associate Dean for Research and Graduate Studies and Institutional Relations. Today, we are delighted and exceptionally honored to be joined by His Excellency, Dr. Ike Ekeweramadu, Deputy President of the Senate of Nigeria and Speaker of the West African Parliament. My colleague, Professor Tangay Renaud, will introduce his honor in a moment, but I'd like to begin by thanking Professor Obi Okafor for his leadership and his vision in organizing the OPUTA lecture and, of course, in coordinating today's event in particular. As many of you know, Professor Okafor is one of Osgoode's leading lights. He is an outstanding scholar and an inspirational teacher. He's published prolifically, and his writings are exceptionally well regarded by all. Now, this event is also being hosted by Nathanson Center on Transnational Human Rights, Crime and Security, as well as the African Studies Program at York and the National Human Rights Commission of Nigeria. The Nathanson Center, I should say, is one of Osgoode's premier research units under Professor Tange Renaud's and the leadership of others as well. It is so much of the reason why Osgoode has such a stellar national and international reputation as a leader in critical, engaged, and innovative scholarship. The Nathanson Center promotes a cross-disciplinary research program to enhance understanding in a variety of transnational issues relating to society, law, and governance. And like all of our research units and research centers, the Nathanson Center emphasizes graduate students as an essential component of the research program. And the Nathanson Center has recently broadened its strategic mandate to not only encompass transnational crime, but also governance. And today's event is one excellent example of that. So on behalf of the law school, I'd like to thank all of you for coming and supporting the innovative and the far-reaching research programs and events at Osgoode and at the Nathanson Center. I will turn over the floor to Professor Tange Renaud, who will provide some more context and insight and introduce our honored speaker this afternoon. Thank you.
Madam Associate Dean, distinguished senators, elected representatives, diplomats, colleagues, we're in good company tonight. Today, I'm pleased to welcome to Osgoode Hall Law School His Excellency Dr. Ike Ekeweramadu to deliver the 2012 OPUTA public lecture, which, as has been mentioned by Associate Dean Puri and Professor Obiora Okafor, is co-sponsored by the Jack and May Nathanson Center on Transnational Human Rights, Crime and Security, of which I am currently the acting director. His Excellency Dr. Ekeweramadu is a lawyer and a member of the People's Democratic Party in Nigeria. He has served as a senator in that country since May 2003, and since 2007, he is deputy president of the Senate of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. His Excellency Dr. Ekeweramadu holds both bachelor's and master's degree in law from the University of Nigeria, was called to the bar of Nigeria in 1987, and has had a distinguished career in private legal practice, as well as a public servant and a politician, both at the level of Enugu State, the national level, and the international level, where he is Speaker of the Parliament of the Economic Community of West African States, otherwise known as the ECOWAS Parliament. He has also taught as an associate lecturer at the University of Nigeria and delivered many public lectures both in Nigeria and abroad. He also acts as chairman of the board of the trustees of the Ikeoha Foundation, which he founded and which awards annual scholarships to hundreds of students from the Enugu West Senatorial Zone, as well as microcredit to farmer groups in the zone. The foundation also runs other projects like vocational training and adult education. Today, Dr. Ekeweramadu will speak to us about security and governance in Nigeria and West Africa. So I can't tell you how honored and thrilled we are to have Dr. Ekeweramadu with us today. So without further ado, our 2012 OPUTA public lecturer, His Excellency Dr. Ike Ekeweramadu.
Our very distinguished colleagues here present, learned professors, fellow Nigerians, our friends from the international community, members of faculty of this law school, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed my pleasure to be here. First, let me just correct the impression in terms of the topic. Yes, originally I was there to speak on the issue of security and the sub-region of West Africa. But because of the contemporary nature of our federalism and the current effort at amending our constitution in order to make it more federal, I was also asked to change the topic to now deal with issues in our federalism. So today we'll be looking at the issues in Nigerian federalism, some of the contentious issues in our federalism. So maybe when I come again, we'll be talking about the issue of security and the sub-region. So for now and for today, we'll be looking at the Nigerian federalism, a case for review. It is my pleasure to be here. Efforts were made last year for me to be here, but because we are running election, it was not possible. And this year we tried to come on the 16th of March. Again, that didn't happen because of the Congresses and Convention of the PDP. But when we chose this date, we decided that on no account will we fail. Said that we must be here to honor our promise to be part of this lecture series. I'd like to thank the organizers for the privilege accorded to me to be part of the discussion. And of course, for honoring our brother and our friend, Justice OPUTA, has contributed so much in legal knowledge, not only in Nigeria, but in the whole of Africa and the world in general. So I'm grateful that he's being recognized in faraway Canada. And the topic we are discussing today is something that's very dear to all of us. And there's no better setting than Canada that practices federalism and is also a member of the Commonwealth like Nigeria. We'll try as much as possible to be brief so that we'll get into the discussion because it's going to be more of an interactive session. So most of the issues we are going to raise are things that you are familiar with. So my major concern today will be how do we find solution to these challenges. So basically, the issue of federalism in Nigeria is something that dates back to our history, the history of colonialism in Nigeria. When the white man came, the effort to find the best possible way of governing the area was something that bothered them so much. And because we have communities that existed before the coming of the white man, so what they did basically was to begin to find a way of bringing these communities and nations, bring them together as one entity. And then we then had the Southern Protectorate, we had the colony of Lagos and then Northern Protectorate. So our federalism didn't start like the classical federalism like the America, where we had independent states coming together on their own to form a union. Because federalism itself is more like a covenant, because federalism is a Latin word, fiedus, which means covenant. So classically speaking, we expect that people who are independent will come together and form a union like what we have in America. But ours was completely different. It's different in the sense that when the white man came, they tried to bring people together and then formed protectorates. And later, it was difficult for them to manage. They decided to bring them further together. That was why in 1906, the Lagos colony and protectorate of Southern Nigeria came under one governance. And by 1914, they have brought all of them together. So the process continued up to 1946, when they decided that it's time to divide this entity into three regions. And then from there, the federalism started to develop. And then from 51 up to 1954, when we had the Little Things Constitution, the issue of federalism was finally concretized. And then there were subsequent constitutional conferences leading to the independence of Nigeria. And we all believed that at that time, that the best type of government that would suit our purpose in view of the different ethnic groups, languages, religion, and all that was something that would give some people some autonomy in the way they govern themselves. And then federalism was therefore accepted. So that was why, even at independence, we decided that we are going to go ahead with federalism. So we continued. So, but in spite of this, we've had several problems. But one thing that's consistent is that we believe that federalism remains the best fashion of government in our own circumstance. So what we intend to do this afternoon to see what are challenges this federalism has suffered, or the heated arguments that's facing us as a country since the time we decided on federalism. So we're going to look at the issue of power sharing, we'll look at the issue of revenue sharing, we'll look at the issue of local government, the issue of state creation, the issue of police, whether we need a central police or a decentralized police. We'll look at some of the issue of integration deficits. You know, so these are some of the issues I'm going to throw up. I'll try as much as possible to be brief in all of them so that we'll be able to get into finding solution to some of these problems. Now, the major issue, which I said one is the issue of power sharing. It's been quite contentious, but because in a federal system, we expect that there are going to be federating units with certain powers. So how these powers are allocated has been a major concern, not only in Nigeria, but in other federal states. So in the case of Nigeria, at 1960, we had the exclusive list, we had the concurrent list. At that point, the exclusive list had, in 1960, we had 28 items in the concurrent list, and then 44 in the exclusive list. That was the time we used to refer to as the golden period of our federalism. But by the time we got to 1999, the concurrent list had lost most of its components to the exclusive list. So you can see that in 1999, of course, in 1999 and 1979, there were copies of our constitution. The 1979 constitution had the similar pattern with the 1999 constitution. So we saw in the case of 1999 constitution, the most of the powers that were already in the concurrent list now moved to the exclusive list. And that's why you can see that we had about 72% of the exclusive list, the total list, the exclusive account about 72% of it, and then the concurrent list was just 28%, which is about 12 items. And these 12 items are just minor issues. And the interesting thing that if you look at the two lists, both the concurrent list and the exclusive list, you see that the certain items you can't find in any of the list. Something like health. Health is not found in any part of the list, either the exclusive list or the concurrent list. So there's need for us to have another look at the list and then see, because the trend these days is for the state to begin, the central government to begin to shade powers to the component units, because it helps the federal government to be, you know, to have enough time to deal with more specific issues that are left in their care. So it's one issue that bothers Nigeria a whole lot. Now, the other issue is issue of resource allocation, because it's also related to the issue of power sharing. Because once powers are allocated to different levels of government, there also need to have resources to run these levels of government. So the issue of resource allocation has been a major, major concern in our federal arrangement. And because after we gained independence, the problem, because it started quite before independence, a lot of commissions were set up to deal with this issue of resource allocation. So it's been a major, major concern. And after we had the first commission in 1946 to look at the process of sharing this revenue, we've had a number of other commissions to look at it. Because the major concern has been, what do we allocate to different levels of government? If you look at the list there, you can see we had in 1946, we had the Philipson Commission, went down to 1951, 53, continually up to 1988, up to 1989, when in fact 1999 really, when the Revenue Mobilization and Fiscal Commission was set up. So federal government had done a lot to try to find a lasting solution to the issue of allocation. And the first thing that they came up with, the issue of derivation. So, and if you look at the period between 1946 up to 1968, the issue of derivation was given prominence. Derivation was then representing about 50% of the allocation. So, but progressively, they suffered a lot of setback. If you look at 1960 to 1970, it was about 50. Then, but sometime in 1971, it went down to 45. 75 to 79, went to 20. In fact, between 79 and 81, there was no money allocated to derivation. Then 1982, it went down, it came up again to 1.5%. By 1989, 82 to 89, we managed 3%. And then by 1999 constitution, it now is provided that at least 13% will be allocated to derivation. So it's been a major concern for the country. And presently, there have been a lot of argument going on between the northern governors and governors from the south-south over the issue of derivation. So these are some of the challenges that we're facing today. We believe that speaking today and then going forward, we shall be able to find a solution to this problem. Now, the other issue, well, I don't want to go into all these details of the vertical and horizontal allocation. So things we'll look at when we go into the discussion. Now, the other issue is the issue of the local government. The local government system in Nigeria has been also quite contentious. By 1976, there was a major local government reform. And the idea of that reform was to have a central system of local government administration in Nigeria. Prior to that period, each part of Nigeria had their own different local government system. So, but by 1976 reform, they had a central arrangement. And at that point, that resources were being allocated to local governments, you know, as a matter of law. And then in 1979 constitution, it became part of the constitution that local government be part of the revenue sharing. Now, because they now got into the revenue arrangement, what has happened is that subsequent government tried to use this as a political tool, creating a local government the way they like. You know, and it, what happened those days was if you are a governor and you're close to the president, then they'll give you more local government. If you're a prominent politician, you get more local government. So things continued in that manner, leading to a situation where today we have 774 local government with all the attendant problems. And if you see the lopsidedness it was created, you will not be surprised the type of the type of challenge that is now causing their country. So basically, we believe that it is an area that we need to look at to see how the issue of local government creation can be resolved. Now, one other problem with local government in Nigeria is that it is not settled whether it's a part of the federating unit or not. Because in America, what we have is two levels of federalism. We have the central government and then we have the states. So the states now decide the number of local governments they'll have. The same thing with Canada. But in a place like India, the situation is different because they have a three-tier levels of federalism. They have the state, they have the federal, and then they also have the local. But in our own situation, our local government is still not well defined where we can situate it in a federal system. Because even the Section 7 of the Constitution provides for the establishment of local government to ensure that they are protected. But if you look at the legislative list of our federation, there's no place that any provision was made for local government to make any kind of law. So basically, it is the state assemblies that make laws for the local governments. So you can't really consider it as a level of government, yet they get allocation. And even the allocation they get are usually through the state government, through what they call the state joint local government account. So it is completely disjointed. So it's a major issue that also needs to be resolved. And then the other issue is the issue of the state creation. Now, if you look at this chart, from 1946, when the three regions were created, we've had a situation where in 1963, and that region was added. And then by 1967, Gowon made it 12 states because of the politics of the war. And then by 1976, it went to 19 by Mortal administration. By 1987, 21 states by Babangida. Babangida moved further to 30 states in 1991, and Gowon finished the job in 1996 by making it 36 states. But in spite of this, the request for states had not ceased. I'm privileged to be the chairman of the Constitutional Amendment Committee. What we have discovered is that every day we have requests for states. As I speak, we have 46 requests, you know. So, and you can see the distribution. From south-south, we have Hawada, out of river states. From south-south, you have Torebe for Delta, south-south, Ogoja, south-south, Urobo. Minji state from rivers, Ado from Delta, Confluence from Kogi, Bori from rivers, Anioma from Delta, Oyi River from, I think that Cross River, 22. You see New Oyo from Oyo, and then here Ijesha from Osho. So it's a very long list. So if you are from any part of Nigeria, just cross check whether your own state where you belong very shortly. So that is the problem we have with states. Now, so the quest for the creation of states will never cease because people believe that, one, it is one way of generating development around the place, but importantly, some people will want to create, you know, some empires for themselves. So that was basically why the issue of state creation took a completely serious turn, and then is creating a lot of tension around now. So when we look at the way forward, we'll decide how do we fashion it, you know, because most of the problem, as we present is from the South, is that feels a lot marginalized, because as we'll see later, the way the states are created, we have seven states from northwest, we have six from the rest, and then southeast has five. So that's created a lot of tension in the country presently. So a lot of effort is being made to see how this imbalance will be addressed. So now the other issue is the issue of I've dealt with the state creation. We'll look at the issue of the police system. Nigeria basically is one of the only federal states where the police system is centralized. And it's been causing a lot of problems. And if you look at the history of our police system, it didn't start off as a central police system, because by the 1916, the Native Authority Ordinance Number 4 of 1916, the local authority were given powers to have their own police because they were vested with the authority to maintain law and order. They even had prison. And the powers of this local police was further enhanced in 1926. Now, the Nigerian police as it is today, the central police we have in Nigeria, came much later in 1930. You know, so we at that point, even when the regions were created in 1946, we had regional police. So we had the Native Authority police, we had the regional police, then we had the central police, all of them working simultaneously up to 1966. So when Irunsi now came, Irunsi decided to review it. And because you recall that Irunsi wanted to form a unitary system of government, and which is one of the reasons he lost his government, because he was overthrown on the reason that he wanted to destroy the federal system, which we all agreed, and set up a unitary system of government. And one of the components was the police, where he wanted to bring police under one unit. So unfortunately, even go on, when they continued, they now adopted Irunsi's approach in the police system, and then they abolished the Native Authority Police and the regional police, and then what we have today, Nigerian police as a single police system had come to be since that period. Now, this has been a major concern in the country because I believe that what we run today is absolutely difficult to sustain. Because if you look at Canada, for instance, they have the central police, they have the provincial police. In America, it's the same thing. In Australia, in fact, in India, each state is empowered by the constitution to set up their own police system. So it's been a major concern for us as a country how to deal with the issue of the police. Now that we have Boko Haram, it has made the matter much difficult, because if the states are allowed to run their own police, then they'll be able to decide which type of police that best suits them. So it is something that I think that we need to look at as we look at the issue of the constitutional amendment, and would like to see your input in this regard. Now, the other major problem is the structural imbalance which we have in our country presently. Now, we have in a country what we call six geopolitical zones, but the six geopolitical zones have their own problems. Now, the states as it is, some states have more local government than others, and that's been a major concern. Let us use maybe Kano and Lagos to illustrate the point I'm trying to make. If you look at Kano, Kano has 9 million people, and Lagos has 9 million. Now, Kano has 44 local governments, but Lagos has 20. So how do we explain it? And that's why Lagos went ahead to start creating their own local government, even when the constitution did not allow that, because they would need to pass through the National Assembly. The implication, therefore, is that because Kano has 44 local governments, they will have assets The gross revenue due to Kano in August 2011 was 5.7 billion, and Lagos had 3.4 billion, yet they had the same population. And what accounted for it was the local government, the difference in local government. So that has created a lot of problem. So the issue now is, what do we do to deal with this issue of imbalance? Do we start creating more local government? Do we abolish the local government? Do we have a sharing formula that will accommodate this imbalance? So the same, the imbalance is also noticeable even in the issue of the geopolitical zones. Next slide. Yes, you see, you can see the Northwest has 7 states, Northeast has 6, North Central has 6, Southwest 6, South South 6, and Southeast has 5. So continuously, the people of Southeast have been demanding for more states. And then this also has implication in local government. If you look at the Northwest, for instance, they have 187 local governments, and the Northeast has 111, North Central 118, and Southwest 137, South South 120, Southeast 95. So the Northwest has about, just the Southeast has half of what you can get in the Northwest in terms of local in terms of local government. If you look at even this chart, you can see obviously the Southeast here and the Northwest. So this is just about half of what you have here. So you expect that in a place such as our own, that people will continue to agitate. So it's something that also we need to look at and to deal with. So even the revenue accruing to the respective zones is also illustrated in this chart. So you can see, and then the implication again is that in terms of the government functions and the some of the appointments that needs equality of states. Now, some states or some zones will get more than the other. And then some institutions like the National Assembly, the Senate, for instance, each state is entitled to 3 senators. The implication is therefore is that Northwest with 7 states will have 21 senators. South-South with 6 states will have 18 senators. Southeast with 5 states will have just 15 senators. So, and then each of the states in Nigeria is entitled to at least 1 minister. So the implication therefore is that while others will have 6 to 7 ministers, the Southeast will have 5 ministers. So this, some of these imbalances are some of the things that are causing a problem. The other issue is the issue of integration deficit. From 1914, which is nearly 100 years, to this period, we've tried to see how we'll work together as a nation. And even after independence and the Civil War, it is expected that by now we would have had more cohesion. But what we see is that people were still fighting ourselves. The enmity, the hatred had continued. Look at Plateau, for instance, the Birom and the Hausa people, and what's happening in Taraba between the Tiv and the Jukun. These things are the things we think that by now would have overcome, but they are still in existence. And despite all the effort, when the National Service, US Service Corps was introduced, the idea was to take people from their areas of origin to other places so that they can interact. And sometimes they'd be encouraged to marry themselves. But all these efforts in 1975, when it was introduced, had yielded absolutely nothing. If you look at 2011, when we had the election, the major targets were the newcomers. And we expected that would have overcome that kind of problem. But that has continued. Now, if you look at Section 147 of the Constitution, it provides that the president shall appoint at least 1 minister from each state who shall be an indigenous. How can we be talking about indigenous in our constitution? And so when we did the ministerial screening last year, when after the election, the Lagos state was very concerned about their own nominees because they claimed that they are not indigenous. In fact, when the members of the Population Commission were appointed and sent to the Senate, the Lagos senators were opposed to Mrs. Bode George. The reason is that Bode George, who is a very well-known Lagosian, his wife comes from Edo State. And so they claim that she cannot represent Lagos because each state is entitled to 1 commissioner. And who do you think was behind all this? Mrs. Tinubu, who herself is from Edo State. But because she has the privilege of being in the Senate, she was worried that somebody she called a non-indigenous is going to represent Lagos. So, and I thought that by now would have overcome some of these integration problems. So it is something that I think that is of major concern to us. So for me, I think that it's to highlight these issues, But the most important thing to me and for all of us is the way forward. So from the foregoing, it is clear that Nigeria's federalism is in a very serious quandary. It's also clear that since the fall of the First Republic in 1996, pretense has taken the better part of our nation as a federal entity. Since the fall of the First Republic, we have been, at best, a federal state in name. It is time to find the way forward. My suggestions: we need to devolve more powers from the center to the federating states. One of the major steps to returning Nigerians' federalism on a strong and prosperous footing is to re-engineer politically viable federal units. As Chief Richard Akinjide, one of the Nigerians' respected legal luminaries, put it recently, the dominance of the federal government is total, and states are just local governments masquerading as states. We must therefore ensure that the states get back on their feet, as in the glorious era of nations' federalism. So we need to go back to 1960 and then look at the legislative list we had at the period and probably copy from it, because there are so many of these things which are now in the exclusive list that needs to go to a concurrent list. Matters such as the railway, things like the police, need to leave the exclusive list and go to the concurrent list, so that both the states and the federal government will be able to have responsibility in respect of this. And education, for instance, are areas I believe that we can have shared powers. There are so many areas like insurance, like labor. I don't see any reason why the federal government should be able to decide the labor law in Lagos, for instance, and determine minimum wage for Enugu state. Each state must be able to have the powers to decide how much they can pay based on their own revenue. So there's absolute need to devolve powers to these units. Now, we also need to revisit the devolution of powers between the state and local government. Since the current half measures have not yielded the required result of grassroots development, we have to adopt either the Canadian model or the Indian model. If we prefer the former, then the federal government will have to completely hands off the local government in terms of any form of regulation and funding, and local government becomes an entirely state affairs and cease to draw funds directly from the federation account. So because I believe that as it is, we continue to have this agitation. So long as we have the type of problem that is facing us today, where, for instance, one state or two states will have more local government than an entire geopolitical zone. So the best thing to do, therefore, is to abolish the local government. Each state will now decide the number of local governments they would like to have. Now, again, is the issue of fiscal federalism. So we need to replace the feeding bottle type of federalism with a true federalism. As earlier stated, the subject of fiscal federation is at the very heart of both the survival and prosperity of Nigeria federal state. In the wake of the renewed and vigorous debate on fiscal federalism, many well-informed Nigerians have continued to pour out their hearts on the need to move away from the current military-imposed feeding bottle federalism to enthrone one predicated on self-reliance, hard work, enterprise, resourcefulness, and ingenuity to catalyze development. Now, the reason is clear. I believe that as it is, each state in Nigeria can be self-sustaining. I believe that every part of Nigeria have enough mineral that can sustain it. I've produced a list covering all the states of minerals you can find in every state. And if we work vigorously, state by state, we can be able to achieve self-sustenance in each state. Abia, for instance, you can see they have glass, they have petroleum. Adamawa, they have granite, they have magnesium, they have limestone. Akwa Ibom, they have clay, they have salt, and all kinds of things. Anambra, they have clay, they have natural gas, they have petroleum. Bauchi have kaolin, and so many other minerals. Bayelsa have salt, petroleum, natural gas, have sand. In Benue, they have crude salt, they have petroleum, they have limestone. In Borno, they have natural salt, they have sapphire, they have gypsum, they have uranium. In Cross River, they have also limestone, they have magnesium, they have salt, they have gold. And so all across Nigeria, from all the way down to Katsina, where you can also have gold, or your state will have granite, you have iron ore. In Plateau, of course, it's the home of solid mineral. Down to Sokoto, where you have also salt, limestone, phosphate, gypsum, kaolin, and all that. So each state in Nigeria, you can find something you can produce that can be used to produce something or export, you know, if well utilized, and be able to generate sufficient revenue. When I was the chairman of the Senate Committee on Governmental Affairs, we did a study with the Small and Medium Enterprises body, SMIDAN. We came up with what they called one local government, one product. we discovered that each local government has something they can produce, either from the solid mineral or from agriculture. So that study was made available to all the local governments, but I'm not aware that any local government had taken advantage of it. The reason is clear, because each month they get allocation from Abuja. So if this allocation is shrinked, I'm sure everybody will be forced to go back to the drawing board. And now that we're talking about setting up the sovereign wealth fund, it is therefore time that I believe most states, when the resources will become lean from the federal allocation, they will now be forced to look at the solid mineral available to them and how they can tap into it. So I believe that this is what we need to do. The next issue is that I believe we need to consider returning to the regions. So because the issue has been whether the state arrangement has helped us, the number of states we've created, whether they have resolved the problem of marginalization, whether they have lived up to the expectations, have they really solved our problem? So the answer to me seems to be no. So we need to see whether we have to restructure Nigeria along geopolitical zones, not going back to the three regions, but maybe a six regional structure where each region will be part of the federating units. And then we may not have another level, maybe the local government, which should be the responsibility of this region. So we will have equal number of, if we have six regions, then each region will now decide the number of local governments they have. It's going to cut short the number of government institutions that which government cater for. It's going to reduce the cost of governance drastically, because each state you have, you're going to talk about commissioners ranging from 20 to 40, advisors of all kinds of shades and character, assistants of all sorts, and then, of course, the aides that you can't even enumerate that are associated with the governor's wife and the governor's brothers and sisters. So, but if we have three regions, all these things will be compressed. Some people have asked me, because I've made this suggestion in a number of places, and they asked me, how would this work? I believe it will work if we try to take into, if we can try to accommodate the interests of those who has an accrued interest presently, like governors who are now in their first term, who believe that they can get second term in 2015. So if we amend our constitution and restructure Nigeria along this path and say, okay, this arrangement will start in 2019, the implication therefore is that nobody will be affected in terms of those who are in government today that will oppose it. So, and then we set up a transition process that will allow us to merge some of these so-called states that are just answering state in name. And then because what will happen is that these geopolitical zones now that will not be provinces or whatever I want to call them, will be able to have sufficient capacity to do certain things which the states themselves cannot do. Because if you devolve powers, and then something like railway, I can't imagine some states that can't even afford doing road, ordinary road, how they can do railway. But if you have regions, they can do, you know, rail lines that will crisscross the whole part of that zone. They can deal with issue of power, you know, and be able to have such sufficiency in power without waiting for the federal government. They can do a whole lot of things. They can create their own security system. But the states, as it is today, will find it difficult to deal with it because they actually lack the capacity to deal with this issue. Now, but before we do that, it's also important that we also try to strike some structural balances, like the issue I gave about Lagos State and the Southeast. While we are trying to have this long-term plan of, you know, trying to restructure Nigeria along, you know, six provinces or six regions or whatever, it is important in order to reduce the tension in the country that we begin to address some of those imbalances that has to do with local government and states. Be able to create, for instance, in the Southeast, if we have more local government, and then we allow states, remove local government completely from the constitution, and then allow states to decide how many local governments they will have, and then they fund it the way they want. Because as it is today, the monies that are going to local government are actually passed through the states. So they can as well be allowed to create the number of states, the number of local government that they believe that can work for them. It's also important for us to work on the issue of integration. As I pointed earlier, the NYSC, which we believe would have helped to bring us together much closer, help us to intermarry, have relationships here and there, which was a very good concept. And for some of us, then we looked up to going to the north to go and serve. And some people settled after that. But you can see what has happened. I think we need to have a look at that program and see how we can also still utilize it to solve the integration deficit, which actually it was meant to do. And then we also need to amend Section 147 and remove the issue of indigene and replace it with the state of residence. And I'm aware that Section 42 of our Constitution has made elaborate provision in respect of areas where you live. And it makes provision to the fact that no person shall be discriminated against on a ground of where he's coming from, his religion, his race, his sex. So it baffles me sometimes when people make legislation in some states, creating a different regime, school fees regime, for those who are indigenous and for a different one for those who are non-indigenous, contrary to Section 42 of our Constitution. And there is a provision for the concern enforcement procedure, what they call the constitutional enforcement procedure rules. And nobody seems to have taken advantage of this provision to ensure that those laws are declared null and void, because that is exactly what it is. Because the Constitution is clear on the issue of discrimination on account of where you're coming from. So, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, in conclusion, I've tried to give a background to Nigerian federalism. I've also explained some critical issues that have challenged us as a federation, providing some ideas on how we can move forward. Definitely, Nigerian federalism has made some progress in spite of the myriads of challenges. I believe that the introduction of the OPUTA lecture was informed by the understanding that every nation is a work in progress. The fact that we live under one political and federal entity, despite the challenges, is a plus, considering that the last few decades have witnessed the collapse of several heterogeneous federations, such as the defunct USSR. Meanwhile, it is not also lost to me that these articulations are by no means exhaustive. As I pointed out at the onset, my responsibility here is primarily to catalyze idea sharing, bringing out the best from this academic and international gathering so we can fine-tune our system, promote democracy, entrench good governance, and increase human happiness in Nigeria. And I take responsibility for all my suggestions. I state here my personal opinion, not the opinion of the Senate of Nigeria, nor indeed the chairman of this Constitutional Review Committee, but my own personal opinion as Senator Ike Ekeweramadu. It's also instructive that a forum like this is heralding the next round of constitutional amendment project, which various levels and arms of government as well as interest groups are getting up to by setting up their individual panels that articulate positions and suggestions on how best they think we could strengthen our nation. It is my hope that these efforts and the next round of our constitutional amendment will benefit from this discussion and ultimately help to put our federalism on a stronger footing. Once more, let me thank you for the opportunity and honor to deliver the 6th annual York University OPUTA Lecture on Governance in Africa. It was President J.F. Kennedy who said to the people of the United States, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country. Therefore, in this same vein, let us today think not of what Nigeria will do to make us better, but what we cannot do to make Nigeria better. God bless you all.
We'll have a few minutes for questions.
Yeah, for questions.
Well, Canada may only have 10 provinces and 3 territories, but being Canadian, I know that federalism is really comes with an unending. Is really an unending source of challenges. So it was wonderful to get a view from elsewhere for me and a comparative perspective for some people in the room. So we have some time for questions. If you wish to ask questions, there are 2 microphones. This session, this lecture is being recorded, so I'd ask you to simply queue up behind the microphones and Mr. Senator will answer question. So please, starting with Madam at the right microphone.
I am Pat Williams. I'm sorry if I have a harsh voice. Now, the speaker has given a brilliant and I think factual delivery, a lecture, and I agree with most of what you have said. However, I'm suggesting that for us to have this, what he considered to be his position, rather than his, that is a position of his office, would it not be useful if we could tackle the issue of education? I say education because if we are going to have the 6 zones that you put forward, There should be informed individuals that should be at the helm of whatever zone that emanated. Now, secondly, I would also think another problem for that entity to evolve would be poverty. And you will agree with us, with me today, that in Nigeria today, I would say 95% of the people are living in abject poverty. So how do we address this? Now, the other bits could be the religious entity, and of course, what you similarly touched upon, the wish for the Nigerian to want to own something, regardless of how he owned it. So I think, first of all, we'll be talking about equity, fairness, and ability for people to understand what it takes in order for them to have delivery. Thank you.
Okay. No, let's take as many as we can first.
Okay, so why don't we take a few? So yeah, Mr. at the other microphone.
Thank you very much for coming around, Senator Ike Ekeweramadu. My name is Bayo Adedosu. I'm the Vice President, Research and Development, Nigerians United Against Corruption, and the Canadian Chair. And I have a few observations to make. Various attempts have been made to amend the Nigerian Constitution. The most prominent one was the one under the Obasanjo regime, which was essentially an effort to elongate his tenure at that time. But to the glory of God, it was a failure. It's been, a lot of money has been spent. A lot of public hearings have been conducted. Before the last election, there was an effort between the Senate and the House of Reps. At the end of the day, of course, we know that a lot of money was spent. Nothing came out of it. Now, we are on that road again. What is the assurance that the present Senate, the present legislature, the two arms actually have what it takes to fashion out a true federal constitution for the country? One thing that Nigerian and Nigerians are known for is sentiment. In everything we do not consider the nation. We always consider the individual, ethnic interest, geopolitical interest. Nigeria was not sensitive about geopolitical politics before. But right now, it's all about what my zone is getting. It's all about what my village is getting. And that is the same thing that is playing out in our body politic today in Nigeria. As it were, it even looks like the political class is completely cut off from the masses that they govern. They are supposed to be the representatives of the people. But what is the feedback mechanism that is in place between the political class and the masses? Oh, that's another thing. Also, we are talking about development of the local government. Let us take cognizance of one thing. Between the two legislatures, we have what is called the constituency project. How have these been monitored?
Sir,
please,
sir,
I need
you
your remarks on this.
We'll have
Thank
to
you.
Keep in interventions short because we have 20 minutes for question.
Yeah.
Would you want to take a few more questions?
Yeah, just one more.
Okay, one more question, and then we'll pass the floor to Mr. Senator.
Hello. My name is Charity Lebianya, and I'm from the eastern part of Nigeria. So first and foremost, that was a wonderful presentation, that has opened our eyes to quite a lot of things. And particularly for me, one of the key things that you mentioned here, which I'm not aware of, is about the resources that could be found in the different states of Nigeria. I'm really amazed at that because we only know a few, the oil and some of the key things, you know. So I just found out for the first time that the resources could be found in the different states. So my question here is, to what extent do you try to create awareness among Nigerians generally, either in the states, overseas, and all that, you know, so that they could tap into these resources? That's one question. Please, I do have two questions and
yes.
One suggestion. My second one is also in your presentation. You seem to also have some of the answers, solution to some of the issues, bordering our nation, in terms of amendment of Nigerian constitution and, you know, the case study and all that. So the question then is, to what extent do you, and when I mean you, the Senate, to what extent do you work towards making the changes? Because from my understanding and your presentation, the last time was during Obasanjo regime, maybe around 1999 or thereabouts, you know. So to what extent does it take a very long time, you know, for you to make the amendment and all that, you know, so on things that will impact the lives of Nigerians? And finally, I just want to, this is just a suggestion, that a lot of people living in diasporas, instead of people, I know that the Senate makes the decision and all that, you know, so you might open a website whereby, you know, there could be a dialogue that people in the diaspora who had been exposed and experienced, you know, Nigerians living in diaspora could participate and give you suggestions. And this might maybe facilitate the entire process. Thank you very much.
Your Excellency. Okay.
All right, thank you for those brilliant questions. Let me go straight to the issue, first issue, but that's on education and then poverty. Now, let me also say that the topic for discussion is the reviewing of our federalism and see how we can make it to work much better. But trying to relate education with federalism, I would like to suggest that, you know, in a way to make education more meaningful, that we need to ensure that the states are more involved, but more importantly, the private sector. In America, for instance, I'm not aware of any federal university in America. You know, most of these universities in America are either state-owned or privately owned or by group missions, you know. So, but in Nigeria, there's a lot of money that's being spent in setting up universities by the federal government. I believe that if the states are encouraged to set up universities, and private sector has been encouraged today, if we sustain that venture, I'm sure that the issue of education will improve. We don't have much problem at the primary and post-primary level. Our major problem in terms of education is at the university level. So that's where we have a major concern. And I believe that if we open the door for more private universities to come on stream, is going to help, and I'm happy that a lot has happened. The federal government has given license to most people, especially the religious organization, to set up their universities. So I hope that over time we're going to see the benefit of this. And of course, some of the areas has been neglected earlier, like the Amajarins in the north. The government has taken a further step to bring them into a Western education, because we believe that, and somebody who is also educated is also enlightened. There are certain things he will not engage himself in, and then of course it opens more opportunities for so many people. So education really is the key. So I think that I agree with you that education is one area that will help in our national development. And of course, education and poverty is also interrelated, because when people are educated, it also helps to reduce poverty. So I agree with you entirely that we need to do something in those regards. Now, there are two questions on constitutional amendment. our brother here and the last lady spoke about constitutional amendment. It seems that we've left Nigeria for so long now that you're not aware that we successfully amended the constitution. I was the chairman of the constitutional amendment committee. It was my committee for the first time in the history of Nigeria that amended the Nigerian constitution. No other person had attempted it. We did it successfully. Section 285 of the Nigerian Constitution was amended to create a time frame for the completion of election petitions. That's why, as I speak to you today, there's no more election petition pending anywhere in Nigeria. Prior to that, election petitions last until the next regime. When I came into the Senate in 2003, there was a case of a petition in Rivers that started in 1999. So the senator had finished his term, had won election to the Senate in 2003, and then the court now decided that the one he went 4 years earlier was null and void, that was not actually supposed to be the senator. So we've looked at that kind of problem. We have started it out by amending Section 285 to create this a time frame of 180 days within which election petition must be concluded by the tribunal. We also amended the aspect dealing with INEC to give them a first-line charge. So they now they draw their money straight from the Consolidated Revenue Fund. So money is not the INEC problem, and that's why the last election was largely successful. Prior to that, too, for you to be a member of the commission, you must be qualified to go to the House of Reps, and then we believe that that is political. For you to be a member of the House of Reps, you are supposed to be a member of a political party. The implication, therefore, is that for you to be a member of INEC, you are supposed to be a registered member of a political party. We amended the constitution to remove that from the constitution. And of course, we allow them administrative independence, so they can do anything what they want to do today without reference to any person. So we focus essentially on electoral reform in our constitution. So we amended so many sections, including the section 153 to 155 that has to do with when the president is ill or indisposed, he needs to hand over to someone. That was also amended. And again, there was a provision in the constitution that says if a governor wins an election and then he's won, he starts all over again. No, we've amended our constitution and said, no, if you win, the ones you have spent will also be taken into cognition. So we've amended our constitution in several ways. So, madam, I want to assure you that we've broken the jinx of constitutional amendment in Nigeria. So the one we are going to do will be based on the trust and confidence of Nigerians that we've done it before. So the money you said that was wasted was not wasted, my brother. It was not wasted. It was well utilized and we achieved the result. So the one we are going to embark upon is predicated on the success of the first one. So I want to assure you that we are on course. And some of the issues I raised here are the things that are going to confront us in the next few weeks. So we welcome your suggestions as we embark in the next round of constitutional amendment. So, madam, also about the website. We have website of the National Assembly, the Senate, and the House. Each member of the House of Reps and each member, senator has a website as well. I have a website as well. We have also the website of the National Institute of Legislative Studies that's also linked to us. So if you Google Nigerian National Assembly, you will see the website. If you Google any senator, you see his also website. Same thing with members of the House of Reps. So if you want to contribute via that modus, it's possible and it's something you can just work out now and then you try it and I'm sure you can get on straight away to my own website. Thank you. We'll take you.
So we'll have time for a few more questions, but this lecture will be followed by a reception outside, so you will have a chance, if you haven't had a chance to ask your question here, to interact with His Excellency following the lecture. So one more question and then a final question here.
Okay. Your Excellency, sir, when in your lecture you had a pointedly outlined a number of factors that have always been staring us in the face with respect to our federalism. You agreed with us that our federalism is skewed. It was a false federation, a federation that was imposed.
Yes.
Given this situation, and in comparison to other federations in the world, United States, Canada, India, Venezuela, where federation flows from the grassroots, where federation originated with the people, against ours, that is an imposed federation. You also pointed out a number of issues that are staring us so much in the face today, especially the politicization of creation of states, which has left some regions in a serious imbalance. Given all these situations, you have also assured us the Senate is making a first amended constitution. Given this imbalance with respect to representation, and knowing that it will be difficult satisfying every section of the country with all these matters that set us in the face, especially with revenue allocation, is there any reason why the current Senate, the current federal government, has not considered it wise to convene a sovereign national conference to address these matters? Because we believe as an SNC will be the only one that can, without regional boundaries or political handicaps, be able to address these matters and satisfy every ethnic nation, every group, every individual in Nigeria with our aspirations to a true federalism. Thank you. Just only one question for you.
My name is Basil Rugochukwu. I'm a student here. I have an initial question, which is, you told us that the Constitution went through some amendments in the past, very recently. And from the presentation you made, the Constitution requires still further amendments. So I would like to know at what stage this process that you're talking about, further amendments, the stage at which it is at this time.
Okay.
And then secondly, building on what my brother said there about the mistrust existing between politicians and Nigerians, I hope you appreciate it when I say that most of the problems that we're having with our federation were created by politicians, and that is why we cannot trust politicians to deal with the problem which they created in the first place, and which is why we're asking for a completely different body, like a sovereign conference, where, or any kind of conference at all, where politicians don't have powers or to deal with the outcome. Because I want to cite some of the examples that you used, the police and the judiciary. You didn't mention the judiciary, but the judiciary is also a problem with our federation, because we have a judiciary that is controlled from the center rather than from the states. And the only reason that is possible is because we cannot trust the politicians, whether they are the state at the federal level. So is it possible for us to trust politicians this time, that they can actually solve problems that they created in the first place? And how are they going to do this? Thank you.
Okay.
I'm told that since there is interest on the floor, we can take two more brief questions. So, madam, if there's somebody else.
Okay, my name is Ijeoma Eko. So, I guess the first question I have is, you spoke of intermarriage as a way in which to solve ethnic conflicts, and also, and you also made a statement about NYS, like the youth service, as and you spoke of intermarriage as the way in which we could use as a way in which we can bring about national unity. And for me, I find that problematic, because I'm saying, to what extent is that dealing with the structural socioeconomic issues, reasons for these conflicts? These conflicts don't come about just because people don't want to marry each other, right? They come about, they have a historical basis. And so if we want to deal with them, I think it's best that we actually deal with the issue as at its roots, rather than to say we're going to ask people to, we're going to have a policy of intermarriage. That's not dealing with the issue, you know? And secondly, I have the question, topic of education. You spoke about trying to make it, try to bring get the states more involved as well as the private sector, and I think that for me, I think that policy almost absorbs the government or the federal government of any kind of responsibility for education. I think that a good education, right now as it is, most children in Nigeria can't afford a private school, right? So for you to say that the private school should have, I mean, the private sector should become more responsive, almost to say that, so what kind of education, like what kind of education are we privileging here, you know? Like the federal government should try as much as possible to make sure that the most ordinary Nigerian is getting good access to education. And if we're asking the private sector to deal with the issues, I mean, we haven't solved the problem, right? Because we know that the rich are always the ones who have access to such kinds of education, you know? So. Yeah, those are the questions that I have. I'm sorry if okay. I was not coherent.
One brief final okay. question.
Thank you for coming. Since you spoke on governance, and we know that for the problem of Africa is not aid, it's governance. And Nigeria, there's no governance. And that extends to the Nigerian missions all over the world. I am talking with particular reference to how all of us here feel about the Nigerian High Commission in Canada. We do not like when the federal government sends somebody that is so detached from the diaspora community here to be our ambassador. We want chosen from among us.
Okay.
That is a message you should take to the president. Thank you.
All right.
So what's their name? What? Acho. Okay. You want to be high commissioner, eh? Okay. So I'll take your message to the president. No. He said she'll take, he's taking from amongst you, and he's one of you. He's entitled.
Yeah.
People
skills.
Okay. Oh, I see. Yeah. Okay. All right, thank you. I've noted what you I will send a message to Jonathan as soon as I get back. But on a serious note, this morning I met with a group of Nigerians, and their concern really was to have a consulate in Toronto to deal with the number of people. I think that is something more serious than choosing one of you to be High Commissioner. The foreign, our first, former foreign minister, Ojomadeko, will be coming here. And I think he's the best thing that will happen here, because basically, when somebody has served to the level of foreign minister, usually in most countries, they end up at the UN. So for you to send a former foreign minister who has seen it all to a mission is also a mark of respect for that country that we're going to receive him. And they are going to do everything to support him to succeed, and most importantly, to ensure that this place is well covered, because Ottawa is quite far from this region. I think it's important that we have the presence of our mission here to deal with some of your problems. Mm. Then the young lady, I've noted what you spoke about in terms of NYC and marriage, so I think that's more like a comment than a question. But for the one in respect of education, I'm serious about it. You see, we've been spending a lot of resources, you know, thinly trying to create universities because we want every state to have a federal university. It has not worked. Education is very capital intensive. If you invest peanut, you get peanut. That's the situation. So, as I said, America doesn't have one federal university. They run a federal system like ours, yet their children are educated. What the issue is, how do they deal with it? What is important is that if we encourage the private sector, private people, organizations, the church, the religious groups, all kinds of people who can set up universities, let them set it up. Now, there will be a scholarship program. There will be education grant, as is done in most countries. Now, most Nigerians who are here, they are paying for their fees. They are paying fees here, and some are on scholarship. Now, those who are paying fees, if we have good universities in Nigeria, they will be in Nigeria, and they'll pay those fees. So, but there are people who can't afford to pay those fees. Then there must be a scheme for them. That scheme is where they now have issue of grants, scholarships, you know, and then so that by the time you finish, you'll be able to repay so that others will benefit from it. So that's the standard practice today. But for the federal government to take responsibility as they're doing now, we'll continue to have the problem we're having. So if you are doing one thing continuously and expect to get a different result, you're not going to get a different result. So if you want to get a different result, you have to change radically to get that result. The important thing for us is the quality of education that we receive, not just the quantity. So if we're going to get that quality of education, we must be able to allow more people to get to invest in education. And government will also provide opportunity for every person who wants to go to school to be able to do so through provision of grants and scholarships. Before, many years back, community trained people. Most of our professors today, they are trained by communities. So if we have social schemes that can provide platform for people to get educated, it is better than what we do today, where government will just, by a law, set up a university. They have one or two blocks. Then the students will be roaming about the whole street. They use private houses as hostels and classrooms. You can't get the quality of education that you're thinking about in that kind of environment. If you compare it with even the private universities in Nigeria, you see a different kettle of fish. So I'm just, as I said, I'm speaking for myself, not speaking for the government here. It is what I consider to be my personal opinion on the debate about education, at least at that level. Well, today we have primary schools and secondary schools owned by private people all over Nigeria, and they are one of the best you can find anywhere in the world. People send their children from America to come back to Nigeria to have secondary education and primary education. So because of the quality of what we have, they can compare with any student anywhere in the world at primary and secondary level. I'm talking about the private sector, secondary and primary education. So if we replicate it at the higher level, we're going to get quality education. So that is my take on that. If you want us to talk about it, we can talk about it when we leave here. Now, I come to the last issue of the issue of Sovereign National Conference, which two of my brothers spoke about. Now, when you are talking about sovereignty, you are talking about the power of the people to institute a government. That's what sovereignty is all about. So now, in the olden days, in the Greek period, where all these things started, they were quite small communities. In that time, they were small. They all come together and make decisions. So, but when civilization came and the multiplication in population, it became impossible for everybody to come and take a decision. So the context of sovereignty moved to the next level, which is representative. So that's where election also came in, for people to be elected to represent a people. So they transferred the sovereignty to those people. So when they're talking about a sovereign national conference, as I hear people speak in Nigeria, it's contradictory in terms. So if you want a sovereign national conference, then you have to dissolve the one you have given the powers to act on your behalf. So, but if you want to maintain it, then you have to also apply what they call the rule of law. So if you talk about sovereign national conference, it's contradictory to the principle of rule of law, which we operate as well. Because our constitution is a set of rules that governs governs our everyday conduct, including the way our laws are made. So if we want to talk about the amendment of the constitution, or in fact restructuring Nigeria, the people themselves are giving some other people, set of people, powers to do that. So if you want to take that powers from them, it is either you are contravening the constitution or you're asking for anarchy. So that is the word. So I don't want to go into those arguments, but I believe that the structure we have on ground today in terms of administration can provide a platform for us to discuss anything under the sun. Anything that can be discussed about Nigeria. I don't have problem Nigerians coming together to discuss. Now, look at the logistics of convoking either a national conference, sovereign national conference, or whatever you call it. Some people are talking about ethnic nationalities coming together. Do you know the number of ethnic nationalities we have in Nigeria? 500? So how do you begin to proportionate it? That is to say, each like Igbos, Hausa, Yoruba, Tiv's, Dukuns, and all that. How do you allocate the number of people that will come? So who is going to lead it? So when they finish, how do that transform into a legislation? How do you implement it? You talk about sovereign national conference where, for instance, there's a military regime. There's no constitutional order. The people can meet. And usually they're also elected at that level to come together and decide what they want. And then it's gone into a referendum, and then it becomes the constitution of the people. Not when you have a sitting government, and then some group of people come and allocate themselves the power to decide how the rest of the country will be ruled, simply because they lost the election. So that's exactly what it is. These people who are talking about sovereign national conference are those who were government a few years ago, who could not be reappointed. I'm not talking about you. Yeah, I'm not talking about you. You're not talking about just this. You're only saying what you hear others are saying. It's not original. What you said is certainly not original. It's not from you. You are telling me what you heard.
It's not true, sir.
What is not true in it?
What is not true is that you're saying it's not original. It's not your opinion.
It's your opinion, but it's not original.
If there is a way to make it work.
Yeah, but would you, in your conscience, say that this is the first time you're hearing it from your own mouth?
Yeah, but Your Excellency, yeah. When we give you a chance to ask people questions on this, yes. I can actually contradict every answer I have
from you. No, I'm prepared to discuss that with you. Yes, because the area I ought to have also tried to research. So I'm speaking from a point of authority on this matter. You know, so the constitution is clear on what needs to be done if we need to amend any section. And constitution is so elaborate that it contains everything that has to do with governance. So at any part of it can be amended, something can be added, and something can be removed. And that's what alteration is all about. You know, so I don't believe in anything called sovereign. There's nothing like sovereign national conference. There's just nothing like that. So the National Assembly, which is in place today, they are going to amend the constitution. There are going to be public hearing. And we want every Nigerian that has an opinion on what needs to be done to come and make that presentation. So we're open to suggestions, open to solutions on how to move our country forward. So nobody's afraid to discuss any particular issue. You know, and I don't see how we'll bring 500 ethnic nationalities to come and decide. How would they agree? Suppose the somebody comes from the north And since they were a unitary government, and I'm coming from the East, and I say it will not work. So where do you take it from? So when you are proposing what needs to be done, you have to look at the logistics and the feasibility and the workability of what you are proposing. You have to do in-depth analysis of what you are proposing. We don't make a proposal for the sake of moving because it sounds good in the ear. You know, so we have to look at how practical that is. So that's the solution. So as I said, we are prepared to amend our constitution. And somebody asks, when will that happen? It is as soon as we resume next week, we're going to start the process.
I'm very sorry. Yeah. I'm very sorry. We have the room until, unfortunately, 2 minutes ago.
So, which one? Let me just find out. What is it? What was that? Okay.
At that point in time, the political class was not representing the interests of the people, or they were not listening or aggregating the agitation of the people. That is one thing that, and the way Nigeria is constituted today is dysfunctional. Whatever point we need to talk, we need to come to that talk. And whatever opinion you want to give as a senator, you need to protect your interests, you need to defend your position. Okay? So whatever you are saying today will be a political opinion.
If you allow me, unfortunately, we'll have to bring this to a close simply because we'll have to take this discussion outside and the time has now run out.
Okay.
But before it's over, I would like to invite Mr. Fabian Noa, president of the Nigerian Canadian Association, to express a few words of thanks for His Excellency. Please.
Okay. I would have responded to it. I have a reply.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency, and thank you, Prof. Fellow Nigerians and our friends, we are very, very glad that we've heard from one of us. In situations like this, I will always say, let us take in all the positive things, think deeply through them, and come out to use them to work out whatever the differences might be that might weaken us. On that note, I will say thank you very much, Your Excellency, and thank you for the OPUTA, organizers of this very particular lecture. The Nigerian Canadian Association is using this opportunity to tell this institution and the committee, we are ready to partner with you for this lecture to continue to go on. And on that note, I will say thank you very much, and we are very pleased.